So basically, I'm going to talk about probabilistic numerics and a little bit about how to solve PDEs like in a probabilistic way. It doesn't work. First of all, let me like basically describe what is probabilistic numerics and what is it all about, and how to do stuff, and why do we need actually probabilistic numerics. Basically, numerical problems can be seen as inference problems. What this means is basically we have some data and evaluate it in some locations. For example, we have like function evaluations in some points, and we want to infer some quantity that is, for example, an integral of the unknown function. This is an inference, basically a machine learning problem. It is natural to go like machine learning way with this problem. A specific approach is like to go Bayesian with this. And this stuff is known as probabilistic numerics. And it is not actually some out of the like air stuff, because many classic numerical methods can be derived like via this probabilistic framework. For example, for this problem that I presented here, the integration, for example, I'm gonna show how to like recover a trapezoid rule, a very basic like integration method via probabilistic approach. But before that, I'm gonna like explain why do we need this? Why do we have to go Bayesian and stuff like this? The answer is, in short, because it's all about uncertainty. Because, for example, in quadrature, like the basic stuff that the basic numerical problem, there is a lot of uncertainty in many places. First of all, we don't know F. We like know some evaluations of F. And therefore we don't know actually anything, like we don't know for sure the integral of F, and a reason to go like probabilistic is to quantify that uncertainty in some way or another. Standard numerical methods can like evaluate their error and stuff like this. So this is a bit contrived, but actually we want to use these solutions or whatever in further computations. So we can like solve some PDE and we want to like use the solution in some further stuff. And numerical methods that are separate, that don't account for uncertainty, they can estimate errors like problem wise, but not like the whole error of stuff. And Bayesian ways can help propagate uncertainty through levels of different computations. Basically Bayesian way is to like replace uncertainty with randomness and stuff like this. So it's all about random things. Another point is that sometimes we want to go another way. For example, we know something about Z in this case, and we want to like infer something about F, and this basically is an inverse problem. Example is we know some PDE and we know its solution, but we don't know like the coefficient in the PDE. So basically it's an inverse problem and it's hard to solve usually with standard methods, but sometimes it can be easy to solve this or like to obtain some answer using like Bayesian stuff, like probabilistic stuff. So this I'm gonna skip, I guess. I want to show you some illustrative example of like literally applying this stuff. And because quadrature is like the most simple, not the most, but like the most visual way of showing this, I'm gonna show Bayesian quadrature. So again, we have some observations and possibly noisy of some function in some locations, we can like measure this function at certain locations, and we want to compute is the integral. I'm gonna show the integral of like some function in interval from -3 to 3. So, but this doesn't make like difference much. So, how to do this actually? Let's place a Gaussian process prior on F. So there was a lot of talk about Gaussian processes. So I'm not gonna reintroduce Gaussian process stuff again. But what's important to know that is that integration like linear stuff, linear operations are closed with Gaussian processes. So basically any linear transformation of a Gaussian process is again Gaussian, and integration is linear. So like integration of F, the integral of F is again Gaussian. And since it's Gaussian and we like have some observations of the function, we can condition on them. And again, conditioning gives a like conditioned Gaussian process that we are able to compute the moments of like the mean and the covariance, or rather variance in this case. How to recover a trapezoid rule? You have to put a specific prior on F, and this is like the prior. It is written basically, it's what you have to know about this is that it's linear in axis, so with some hyperparameters, but it doesn't matter. And we can actually compute the variance of the integral z in this case. It's double integrated kernel of the prior, and it's actually computable. And then we can condition this stuff on our data. So we have some like evaluations of the function in some points, and we condition. And basically, there goes standard conditioning formulae of Gaussian process. I'm not gonna explain. I think it's. It is the usual stuff. Basically, you have your covariance matrices inverted and applied to your data, and then integrated the formula in below is like the posterior distribution of the integration of the integral. Here we have like arbitrary and data points, and actually we can optimize the posterior variance with respect to this. Basically, we want like a small variance, so like a huge certainty about the value. And with this specific kind of kernel, like linear kernel, you have actually an equidistant grid in like, I should have mentioned that this is like one dimensional problem. So we have an equidistant grid here you can see like a picture, some function, doesn't matter what function this is, but some data a little bit here it actually is. It goes to the data, but like the picture is yeah, a bit broken. But anyway, with this kernel, the posterior mean is actually a piecewise linear function, and since I showed you before, for integration of this stuff, we actually integrate this mean, and well, what it means is that basically we recover the trapezoid rule. So yeah, in a way we like derive the trapezoid rule using some just some Gaussian stuff, Gaussian process stuff. And what's the outcome of this is actually we not only compute the mean of the like our posterior integration, but we can actually compute the error bars, like the uncertainty. So here you have like a lot of data and some uncertainty about it, and when you integrate this, the like uncertainty propagates through integration, and you have error bars about the the answer. So okay, I think it was like super visual in example of what is probabilistic numerics, but I'm gonna talk a little bit more about other stuff, in particular PDEs. But before that, does anyone have questions? Okay, I guess either everyone understands or no one understood anything, or maybe a bit of both.
I have suggestions for further development, but this is better to the end.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, okay. So basically what you have here is a posterior distribution of the process that we are then integrating. So here you you have some data, but not all of the data, and in between the data there is a lot of there is an uncertainty about the function. So it can the graph shows basically what a confidence interval of where the function values can lie, and because you are integrating this you're integrating this, you have your uncertainty about the the integral value as well. I didn't show you the error bars about the integral because, yeah. Right. Yeah. This is actually a very good question, because of course we don't want some uncertainty. We want so-called, I don't know, calibrated uncertainty maybe. So basically you want an uncertainty that accounts for the actual error in your estimate of the integral. And this is a very good question, because for this case it's actually connected. So that uncertainty here is connected to the error in the integral. But in general case, it's an interesting question whether whether these error bars are actually error bars or some indication of you don't know something. So did I answer your question?
Necessarily the process is the
Right. So yeah, again, thank you, because yeah, we have chosen this type of Gaussian prior, but actually we are not constrained by this. We can choose any kind of kernel based on any kind of prior based on our assumptions about the underlying function. So like a Matern kernel, for example. Okay, let's go on. I think, yeah, I have like 20 minutes. Okay. Actually many problems can be reformulated in the probabilistic manner. I'm not going to talk about all of them. You can just mention a couple. Solution of the system of equation, of a linear system of equations via a conjugate gradient method is also derivable via like this type of stuff. So basically you put like a prior on your inverse matrix and stuff like this. And ordinary differential equation solvers can also be reformulated in this way. Many type of stuff is like actually implemented and usable, but a little bit about ODE, because I think it's gonna be like important in the last part of the talk. Again, no, nothing technical, but just an intuition about what is going on. Is so you have your like initial value problem, and you want to like solve it. So basically, what here is happening is that you stack derivatives of the like your unknown function into some state X capital, and why derivatives? Because you want like Kalman, you want like Markov properties of this stuff. So if you think about that, about this like that you have like discrete time, then with specific choice of the prior on the X, you have basically Markov property. Okay, but then you have like you apply basically extended Kalman filter, which I'm not going to explain either. And you condition on like your data, which is basically that your first derivative is some nonlinear function of your zeroth derivative. Visually, it's like here, I think. You have your derivative stacked in some vector xn, and at time tn you condition on zn, which is basically like your derivative, your differential equation, and then you predict the next state via this state. Okay, so this is a lot, this is like hand wavy and stuff, no technicalities, but just an intuition, I guess. So here we come to like solving partial differential equations. Here comes the interesting part, I think. Well, at least to me. So yeah, kind of a setup. You have like a partial differential equation, why apply probabilistic numerics here? You don't have knowledge about your like right hand side, or like your boundary conditions entirely. Like you may know like only some evaluations of this, and this is uncertainty. Then you just, usually you can't solve it analytically, you solve it via some numerical method, and it gives like an error, so like a solution with some error, and you want to like estimate this, like to account for this error in a probabilistic way. And the actually the most interesting stuff is that you actually don't, you may not know the equation. What I mean by that is, well, example is you know like the form of equation, but you don't know the coefficient or coefficients. And this is actual stuff that happens a lot. For example, I have an example in oil industry where you have a history matching problem. So basically, you observe your oil excavation data, and it is derived via some solution of some PDE that. Basically speaking, the depends on the permeability, which is itself unknown in all the reservoir or something. Basically, it's an inverse problem. So how to find the permeability or something, given that you know your historic data. And because it's an ill-defined problem, and so basically you don't know, you can't know anything, you can't know much about the answer, so you have to account for this, and maybe Bayesian methods may help this. I should have come back a little bit and talk about about this stuff. So here append another stuff here, like a coefficient of the equation or something, and derive this coefficient using your data. So suppose you know a solution, but you don't know the coefficient. So it basically the same picture, but here you predict the n. I don't know if it is understandable, but okay. What is there to know is that in OD type of stuff you can actually solve inverse problems, and the good thing is that it can be done in single pass. So in standard situation, you have to solve a lot of this type of problems in a cycle. But with this type of methods, you can just solve it once and obtain your estimates of the unknown coefficients. Maybe something like this can be done for PDEs, I don't know, because, this is still an active area of research. Okay, I'm gonna show you an example of a solution of some PDE, before that, just some, again, basic Gaussian machinery. So assume that the operator is actually linear, and Gaussian distributions are well behaved under the linear transformations. So what it boils down to is that you place a GP prior on the solution, unknown solution, and you have your here I wrote down the covariances basically it's just to say that the covariances are computable, but anyway you have your GP prior and you have the data, which is basically that the boundary condition and the linear partial differential equation, which is serves as the data in this case. And this gives you a posterior process on U conditioned on your boundary conditions and on your equation in a finite number of points. So here are technicalities. Basically, you have your data, which is like boundary points and some like some grid on the area that you solve your PDE on, and you have your data, which is basically like your boundary conditions and the right hand side of your equation. And here you have again like your Gaussian type of, yeah, this is a, there is an error in this formula, sorry about that, but what is there to know is that it's actually computable through usual Gaussian type of machinery. So a picture will come in a little time. So consider this example. You have like your derivative of time derivative and space derivative. Their sum is equal to zero. And you have your initial initial condition at time zero. You know your function on the whole space of R, on the whole like real line. And what is important, I think, is that we treat time here as like basically in the same way as space. We don't make distinctions, and for this case. And this is important, I guess. Yeah, and we know analytical solution, and we can like see what this does it work or not. Basically, yeah, this is a picture of what is going on. So yeah, let me explain what is shown in this picture. So yeah, we have your like initial boundary data here. I think it's invisible, but anyway, there are like 10 or something points in which we evaluate our boundary conditions. And initial data. But yeah, you know, we like know the initial data, initial function on the whole line, but we only condition on this data, and we condition on differential equations in this square. We know the truth, and we want to solve it using Gaussian machinery that I showed earlier. And what we see is that it actually is able to solve well, like with the restriction that it can only like solve where it sees the data. So we note that the solution here actually depends on the data here, on the initial data here, which our Gaussian process doesn't see. So it can't reliably tell what is going on here. So it basically goes down to zero and like blows up the uncertainty, the standard deviation. Here in the area where it actually has seen the data and the equation, the error is small, the standard deviation is also small, and here the error is big because it doesn't know what's going on there. But suppose that we somehow introduced the data here. So I guess it doesn't make very much sense in the PDE type of knowledge or machinery. But for the Gaussian case, we can actually do this because it doesn't care about time or space or something like this. So yeah, suppose we somehow know that the function at zero is this for all our types. Again, not for all, but for some of our times. Then the Gaussian process, it sees this data and says, okay, I know what to do here because I know the differential equation and the data. And so the standard deviation goes down and the error is, it's shown here. It's it's not very big. You can see that in this case the variance is not very well calibrated because error is if you can see it's
exists.
Yeah, it exists, and it's like this, I don't know, waves of weather or something like this, and standard deviation doesn't show this behavior. But well, I guess it could be like fixed by using a more proper prior for this type of problem. Do I have the time? Oh yeah, randomness is in the answer. So what you see is yeah, okay. This is deterministic equation, but what is random here is that first of all we don't know the boundary conditions or actually the equation in all of the space. We just know it in some points. So for example, here you just know that boundary conditions in these points. I don't know. I guess I can. Yes, we interpolate this using Gaussian process, and so I guess we can write it more precisely. I propose after the talk, but to answer your question, so we know the like initial conditions in some points, not on the whole points, and we know the equation in some points, not on the. Yeah, in this case, yeah, it's without the noise, but of course you can introduce noise, and it's natural to introduce noise. It's just an example of, like, so we don't have to explain noise or something. What you have actually as an answer is not a like exact or a fixed answer, a fixed mean, because you actually can't know this, because you don't know your data, like your initial function entirely, or you don't know the equation entirely, so you can't have actually a fixed answer. Instead, you get a probabilistic answer. That means you have a distribution, so distribution of answers, which is Gaussian, and which mean and standard deviation of are shown in the picture. Okay. I have a little bit time, like 5 minutes, I guess. Yeah. 10 minutes. Okay. So, okay. It's nice because, yeah. Statfem. I'm gonna skip this because, well, basically, you have like your like finite elements, you like discretize your space into some mesh or something. You have your solution as a like sum of basis functions with some weights, and you place Gaussian process prior on the weights, and you write your PDE in the weak form, and basically what you get, again, if L is linear, which it was all assumed, you get to see some system of equations, of linear equations. And again, Gaussian processes are super easy to use when you have your, well, theoretically easy to use when you have your linear stuff. Basically you get your posterior, which is posterior on the weights of the FEM solution. And So, okay, I'm going to skip this. What about nonlinear PDEs? Again, nonlinear cases, well, I don't know. It's hard. Actually, in some cases, we can do something. And here I want to like show you basics of probabilistic numeric method of lines. Probably the people from the PDE community here know more than I about the method of lines, but I'm gonna show nonetheless some probabilistic stuff about this. So, okay, consider this type of equation, partial differential equation. Here D is a like again linear differential equation operator that acts on space on X, and F can be nonlinear. Yeah, and we have to solve for U with some boundary conditions. Again, I'm skipping this for like brevity for some time. It turns out that if you like replace the your D, your like calligraphic D with like some matrix vector product, D times U evaluated on some grid X, then it supposedly it turns into a system of ODEs, and then you like basically solve it using standard ODE solvers. So you can so the goal here is to like combine this approximation with the probabilistic ODE solver, so that the whole like pipeline is probabilistic, and the uncertainty is propagated through like the pipeline. And so the method is actually concerns with the approximation of the D. Of the calligraphic D. I'm gonna show you So there should be more pauses here. Okay, so let there be some a GP that lives on space on omega, which is a well-defined, some well-behaved domain. So let's introduce another GP, which is basically you condition on V and then apply the calligraphic. And formulae here are, well, again, standard Gaussian conditioning. Here, what is there? We have some like mean, and some covariance, yeah, which is written in this way. So, this stuff is actually the covariance of the calligraphic V. Let's introduce auxiliary GP with this covariance. So it's independent of V because the covariance is independent of V. So it doesn't depend on the data or something. So it's independent. And this stuff like is, if you do the algebra like simple cancellation, it's this, the covariance of this is D times D adjoint on K, and this is actually equal to distribution to this stuff. So this is just differentiation, like applying our differential operator on V, on our original V. So on the grid, we have the following thing. We have something about V, like some matrix V applied to V, and some random GP, like a random vector that can be seen as error. And here I write quasi finite differences because it's, of course, it's not quasi, it's not finite differences, but like it acts like finite difference in the sense that it like approximates the action of the partial differential operator on our V. So I guess it's kind of it could be like not easily translatable in this constrained environment, but anyway, so it acts like if find a different operator. Actually, if it should be again furtherly approximated by zeroing out non-neighboring covariances. So basically, what you do is you take your neighbors and every other points are zeroed out in the D, every other pair of points. So basically what in 1D case, I guess I can like draw.
So here in 1D case, you have your neighbors and you have some covariance, but you only consider covariances between neighboring points. So you have a like banded matrix.
So it resembles finite differences, and so it's actually called radial basis function generated finite differences, and it's like seen in the literature and stuff. But we like just diagonalize this like take the diagonal of this matrix. And so we have some approximations to the calligraphic, which is our partial differential operator on some grid X, which is actually probabilistic in nature. And therefore, we can apply our probabilistic numerical ODE solvers to this type of problem, this type of approximation, and obtain a probabilistic answer. Probably it's very hard to understand because I skipped all the technicalities and all the stuff, but the idea is that we can actually produce some kind of a probabilistic approximation to to our partial operator, so that we can solve a nonlinear PDE of this specific type of like form and get some probabilistic answer. So this is basically what I just told. So we can solve this type of equation using some kind of probabilistic technique, the details of which I skipped. And I guess I'm gonna finish. But before that, I'm going to sum up. So probabilistic numerics as a field of research is like, it's old, but it gains more attention recently. And again, many classical numerical problems can be reformulated. A most important use case is like solution of inverse problems, which could be done easier than in classical case. And what is interesting, like the most, is like solving nonlinear PDEs with this type of stuff. So I guess that is all. Thank you very much. Do you have any questions? I did not show this because it would be too like it's why do we do this? Because in this what I have showed you is the way to like write the differentiation operator, the PDE operator that acts on space in the way that produces a problem solvable by probabilistic ODE solvers. Otherwise you have like your you can't propagate your you write that it's linear, but it can't be propagated through F, which is nonlinear. But if you write this type of approximation, it actually can be solved via ODE solvers. Yes.
And then from linearity, it's not very scary because
That is right, yes.
So linearizing
process is still linearizing. Yeah, doing this very, very smartly linearizing.
You solve the obvious.
It was in a talk by Philip Hennig. But again, yeah, it is basically Kalman filtering, and well, again, I didn't want to like delve into all the technicalities because it would be like not 45 minutes, but like more 2 hours or something. Just wanted to show some, like to introduce people who are not introduced already to the probabilistic numerics type of problems.
Can you show some examples of
No.
What would be the two examples? Show very nice two examples for linear here, which I personally was super impressed for the results. And but maybe you can show something for not linear TV.
I guess after the talk we can just discuss this in a more like in a more informal type of discussion and in Russian.
So I have another question with this. So when you recast the PDE into ODE, does the dimensionality of the ODE become like the number of pixels in this grid that you have?
Yeah, I guess so. But yeah.
Okay.
So basically, yeah, you have like your ODE for each pixel or something.
Okay,
like this.
So this is a huge system of ODEs.
Okay.
Is it assumed that they are all ones? Or what we were talking about is in some
simulation framework.
Is it always like this? Or?
I don't know any other like counter examples. But again, I'm not super well versed in this type of method, so I can't be sure. But like 100% sure.
Yeah, I guess you can always parameter, but the third one they can assume something parameter and solve it. But parameter and solve it. And this is what they do for one group.